Long has reveille echoed across the lofty peaks of the Huachuca Mountains, which rise out of the San Pedro Valley in southeastern Arizona. Nestled in Huachuca Canyon is Fort Huachuca. The post rose from its beginnings as a central outpost during the Indian Wars of the late 19th century to become one of the most critical installations in the Department of Defense today. Its history is a vibrant, rich saga in the annals of the United States Army and military intelligence. Long before the U.S. Army established a foothold in this corner of the nation, the Apaches staked claim to its vast expanse of harsh, high desert and towering, jagged mountains. The Apache resisted encroachment to their homeland by Anglo-American settlers in the mid-1800s, often leading to bloodshed on both sides. In order to bring peace to this region and to secure the U.S.-Mexico border, in 1877, Colonel A.V. Kautz, commander of the Department of Arizona, ordered Captain Samuel M. Whitside and two troops of the 6th Cavalry to the area to select a site for a new outpost. On March 3, 1877, Camp Huachuca was established. Captain Whitside selected a site with fresh running water, abundant timber, excellent observation in three directions, and protective high ground that provided security against Apache raids from the rear. Over the next century, the post's strategic location and unique qualities would continue to ensure its survival within the modern army. Several different cavalry and infantry units occupied Camp Huachuca during the Apache campaigns for over 10 years, including B Troop, 4th Cavalry, which participated in the final capture of the Apache leader Geronimo, ending the Indian War period in Arizona. U.S. Army troops were assisted by Apache scout companies, who provided valuable intelligence during reconnaissance patrols throughout the region.
I assert that these Chiricahua scouts did excellent service and were of more value in hunting down and compelling the surrender of Geronimo and his followers than all other troops engaged in operations against them combined. During the entire campaign, every successful encounter was due exclusively to the exertions of the Indian scouts.
General George Crook, Commander, Department of Arizona.
For many years, Indian scouts had represented an effective method of intelligence collection by the U.S. Army. Indian scouts were not unique to Fort Huachuca, but the post did provide them a permanent home until the last scout retired in 1947. In February 1882, the camp was designated a permanent post and was officially named Fort Huachuca. Buildings soon sprang up where tents once stood. Two-story officer quarters and troop barracks lined opposite sides of the parade ground. Between 1883 and 84, a reservoir was built on what is now Reservoir Hill, followed by a post hospital in 1885. Army Surgeon Leonard Wood was assigned to the hospital when he served at Fort Huachuca in 1886, though much of his time was spent in the field during the hunt for Geronimo.
Fort Huachuca is in good repair, and on account of its proximity to the Mexican line and the railroad leading into Mexico, should be retained and fully garrisoned for some years to come.
Colonel Benjamin H. Grierson, Commander, Department of Arizona, 1889.
In fact, by the mid-1890s, all permanent U.S. Army posts in southern Arizona had been closed, with the exception of Fort Huachuca, which was retained to maintain law and order in the border region. Lawlessness along the border became especially troublesome during the Mexican Revolution, which began in earnest in 1910. By this time, the Army had sent numerous regiments to Arizona Territory, including the famous African-American Buffalo Soldiers of the 9th and 10th Cavalry and the 24th and 25th Infantry Regiments, all of which served at Fort Huachuca at various times between 1892 and 1940. By 1913, turmoil in Mexico was spilling over the border. President William Howard Taft ordered additional troops to the border, making Fort Huachuca the focal point for patrols and the logistics efforts west of El Paso, Texas. It was at this time that the renowned 10th Cavalry arrived at Fort Huachuca. For the next two decades, the regiment maintained a continuous presence at the Southern Arizona Post. In 1916, after the Mexican revolutionary Pancho Villa crossed into the U.S. and attacked Columbus, New Mexico, the 10th Cavalry joined General John Pershing's punitive expedition into Mexico. The 10th fought decisively at the Battle of Agua Caliente and again when it rode to the rescue of besieged American troops near the town of Parral in central Mexico. First Sergeant Vance Marchbanks presented a picture of the arduous campaign.
The 1916 Pershing Punitive Expedition was the most demanding ordeal any of these soldiers had ever experienced. For more than 11 months, the 10th Cavalry was in the field. Native beef and parched corn was the principal ration, and for many days the men were without salt. Men wore out their clothes and shoes and were obliged in many instances to use their shelter tents for patches and their stirrup hoods tied around their feet to keep them from being absolutely barefoot. First Sergeant Vance H. Marchbanks.
Pershing withdrew his forces from Mexico in January of 1917 to prepare for the eventual deployment to France during World War I. When designing his American Expeditionary Forces headquarters, Pershing used much of what he learned in Mexico to develop his intelligence assets. Meanwhile, the 10th Cavalry returned to Fort Huachuca and resumed its vigilance of the border. The threat from the south appeared to be real. Specifically, the Army received numerous intelligence reports about subversive German activities in Mexico. On January 18, 1918, in Nogales, Mexico, Lothar Witzke was taken into custody. An encoded letter from the German consul was found in his possession, which read, "The bearer of this is a subject of the Empire who travels as a Russian under the name of Pablo Verbersky. He is a German secret agent. Please furnish him on request protection and assistance. Also advance him on demand up to 1,000 pesos of Mexican gold and send his code telegrams to this embassy as official consular dispatches." Witzke was sentenced to death, but his sentence was later commuted to life in prison. After World War I, the 10th Cavalry settled into regular garrison life, completing civil engineering projects when needed and regular training exercises as required. Continuing unrest along the Mexican border kept them vigilant and also underscored the wisdom of retaining Fort Huachuca in an era of drastic army reductions.
Besides garrison duty, we rode trails all over and made night marches to Tombstone and the Empire Ranch over in the Whetstones, Benson, St. David, Nogales, back and forth. Captain Clarence Richmond, Provost Marshal, Fort Huachuca, 1921.
By 1930, the days of the horse cavalry had ended. Many of its responsibilities were more easily handled by mechanized vehicles and aircraft. The 10th Cavalry was replaced at Huachuca by the 25th Infantry Regiment in 1931, and for the next 15 years, the post served as a training center for various infantry troops in anti-aircraft, rifle combat, communications, intelligence, machine guns, chemical warfare, and truck driving, among other courses. In late 1940, a new cantonment area was constructed to transform the post into an infantry training center to support up to 25,000 African-American troops. In May 1942, the 93rd Infantry Division arrived at the training center. Following extensive training, the 93rd shipped out to the Pacific Theater in 1943.
The 93rd Division left that post, did train in the desert at Thousand Palms, did go to Louisiana for training, did go overseas and participate in some of the fightings in the Southwest Pacific. And so I guess you'd say the 93rd did all right.
The 92nd Infantry Division arrived at Fort Huachuca on the heels of the 93rd. They left for Italy in 1944, distinguishing themselves on the Arno River and later assisting in the penetration of the Gothic Line. Two Women's Auxiliary Army Corps, or WAC, companies also were stationed at Fort Huachuca during World War II. Fort Huachuca deactivated on September 15, 1947. 4 years later, at the beginning of the Korean War, the Army reactivated Fort Huachuca under the jurisdiction of Commanding General 6th Army. An Engineer Aviation Unit Training Center was established to instruct engineers in airfield construction. These men built Libby Army Airfield. At the conclusion of the Korean War, the post was briefly closed for a second time. After nearly 75 years as a tactical cavalry and infantry post, Fort Huachuca opened a new chapter as a strategically critical installation for the U.S. Army in 1954, when the Army Signal Corps sent the 1st and 505th Signal Groups to reopen the post. The unique topography of the region provided vast areas free from electromagnetic interference, ideal for the testing of electronic warfare equipment and unmanned aerial vehicles, or UAVs.
Geographically, if you look at Fort Huachuca, you'll see that it resides inside of a bowl where it's surrounded on all sides by mountainous regions. The electromagnetic environment here is considered pristine even today.
The Army Combat Surveillance and Target Acquisition Training Command, later SCHOOL, stood up in December 1957 to teach surveillance technicians how to operate and maintain new families of radar and infrared electronic equipment for ground and aerial use. Additionally, students trained in the use of new aerial cameras mounted on UAVs, which continues today. UAVs had largely served as aerial targets for ground-to-air and air-to-air gunnery, but in the mid-1950s, the Army began pursuing their use for photo surveillance. As early as 1955, the Army Electronic Proving Ground at Fort Huachuca mounted Signal Corps cameras on remotely piloted planes and launched them into the air from a catapult. This began Fort Huachuca's long history with UAVs. The pace of activity intensified in the 1960s as the Army Security Agency Test and Evaluation Center arrived at Fort Huachuca. The Army Security Agency also established an electronic warfare school on the post. It merged a few years later with the Combat Surveillance and Target Acquisition Training School to become the Combat Surveillance and Electronic Warfare School. One of the pieces of equipment familiar at the school was the OV-1 Mohawk, a fixed-wing aircraft built specifically for the U.S. Army. While pilots completed flight training at Fort Rucker, Alabama, training of the Mohawk Technical Observers, or TOs, was conducted at Fort Huachuca. Some of the unique capabilities of the Mohawk were its side-looking airborne radar, or SLAR, and its ability to take nighttime photos.
I was very impressed by the schooling that I received in Fort Huachuca. I thought it was thorough. Aimed at preparing you for a combat situation. Very, very impressed with the whole schooling period that I had at Fort Huachuca. We trained at Fort Huachuca in every step of the way, from camera to SLAR, which was the radar, the infrared. They were three mini courses within the entire course. And at the end of your training in each of those areas, you would fly at least one mission, maybe two. In the case of camera, you've probably flew two because you'd fly one in the daytime, and then you go back and fly one at night using the flares that were on board to illuminate the target on the ground. So you probably flew anywhere from three to five missions at Fort Huachuca. I mean, I was flying within 10 days after I got to Vietnam. Because there wasn't that much of adjustment, Fort Huachuca had made such a complete instruction out of being a TO that nothing surprised you when you got to Vietnam.
In addition to these training and testing activities, the U.S. Army Strategic Communications Command established its headquarters and became the senior unit on post. STRATCOM exercised full command and control over the Army's worldwide strategic communications from this corner of Arizona. Through its Safeguard Communications Agency, it also managed the communications networks of all the Safeguard ballistic missile sites throughout the U.S. While some intelligence training had been going on at Fort Huachuca since the mid-1950s, a new era began on March 23, 1971, when the U.S. Army Intelligence Center and school moved from Fort Holabird, Maryland. When overcrowding at Holabird during the Vietnam War necessitated a new training site, Fort Huachuca proved an ideal location. Major General Joseph McChristian, the Army's Assistant Chief of Staff for Intelligence, was one of the prime movers in establishing Fort Huachuca as the home of military intelligence.
My concept is basically this: a home where all intelligence schools, all intelligence units, and all intelligence activities of the Army that are not required to be located someplace else are established for the first time in our history, where they can work together and find out how one can help the other. Because it is teamwork. You do not do intelligence in compartments.
They must help each other on the battlefield. Major General Joseph McChristian, 1972.
The next two decades were a time of steady growth for the Intelligence Center and School. In 1973, it offered 37 courses of instruction, including the MI Officer Basic and Advanced courses. The school absorbed the Combat Developments Command Intelligence Agency, the Combat Surveillance and Electronic Warfare School, and the 6th Army Training Aid Center. It assumed further responsibilities for surveillance, target acquisition, night observation, and combat developments as related to intelligence training, doctrine, and organization. As the center's mission expanded, so too did its physical footprint. Initially, the Intelligence Center and school had moved into temporary wooden facilities built during World War II. By the 1980s, however, new academic buildings and barracks were under construction to house a growing student population. In 1982, the school also began offering the Signal Intelligence and Electronic Warfare Officer classes, previously conducted at Fort Devens, Massachusetts. The center and school added proponency for the remotely piloted vehicles, unmanned aerial vehicles, the Joint Surveillance Target Attack Radar System, or JSTARS, and the All Source Analysis System, or ASAS, thereby taking a wider responsibility for intelligence and electronic warfare assets. At the same time, the Intelligence Center gained responsibility for battlefield deception and battlefield weather operations and the consequent large increases in the training load. When the Non-Commissioned Officers Academy opened its doors in 1987, MI professionals of all ranks were receiving their training at Fort Huachuca. July 1st, 1987 was a momentous day in the history of Army intelligence. Major General Julius Parker, the commanding general of the U.S. Army Intelligence Center, presided over the activation of the Military Intelligence Corps. He became its first chief and coined the Corps' motto, "Always Out Front." Major General Julius Parker described the necessity for the Corps.
The Corps really represented all aspects of intelligence. The branch didn't develop concepts and doctrine. The branch was not responsible for the training of the officers and the non-commissioned officers, but the Corps is the breath and life of intelligence.
While the role of MI and its significance to the Army continued to expand, the final piece of training fell into place at the Intelligence Center when the Army decided to close Fort Devens, where signals intelligence training had taken place since the 1950s. By 1994, responsibility for all signals intelligence and electronic warfare courses for enlisted personnel had transferred to Fort Huachuca, although training continued to take place at Goodfellow Air Force Base in Texas and the Naval Air Station at Pensacola, Florida. Finally, all military intelligence training for officers and enlisted alike was consolidated into one location. Fort Huachuca truly was the home of military intelligence. At this time, the Intelligence Center shifted its emphasis to the development of a number of ground and air sensors, such as TeamPAC, Trailblazer, TrackWolf, REMBAS, Trojan Spirit, Aerial Reconnaissance Low, Guardrail, and the Quick Fix Helicopter. Through extensive construction projects, the Intelligence Center also evolved into a college campus-like environment, a total transformation from its original location in what had been referred to as Splinter Village. Other organizational changes were occurring at Fort Huachuca during this time as well. In 1989, the Department of Defense stood up the Joint Interoperability Test Command, or JITC, to provide interoperability compliance testing and certification and serve as the lead for DoD Command, Control, Communications, and Intelligence, or C3I. The following year, the Army Training and Doctrine Command assumed command of Fort Huachuca, making the Intelligence Center the senior mission on post. The Army Information Systems Command, formerly the U.S. Army Strategic Communications Command, which had established its headquarters at Fort Huachuca in 1967, served as the senior mission for 23 years, becoming a tenant organization. The last decade of the 20th century ushered in more than organizational changes at Fort Huachuca. On August 2, 1990, the Iraqi forces of Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. Military intelligence units and newly developed technologies from Fort Huachuca were quickly mobilized and sent to Saudi Arabia as part of Operation Desert Shield. On January 10, 1991, the 36-man unmanned aerial vehicle platoon of the 304th MI Battalion, 111th MI Brigade, deployed to Operation Desert Shield. The platoon was the only Army organization that operated the Pioneer, a 400-pound propeller-driven UAV with a camera capable of day or night monitoring of the battlefield. The technology was so new that few outside the MI Corps were aware of its capabilities.
We're out flying one night. We see this truck just traveling across the desert. And I mean, it's just dirt across the desert. We're like, let's just follow him, see where he goes. We had a lock target function, put the crosshairs over the truck. It immediately puts a box over. Just sit back and let the airplane do the work. And then we realize what has occurred is a spider hole has opened, and he's the chow run. And by the way, we could tell by how many sack lunches he was bringing that it was now a target of opportunity. And so we got on the phone and said, hey, we need to call for fire. And don't know what that complex was, but it was big. As far as the quantifiable outcome of that, there was a big survey that ran around after Desert Shield, Desert Storm. Pioneer was in the top 10.
Another new technology deployed for the first time in combat was the Hawkeye, developed by the Artificial Intelligence, or AI, laboratory at Fort Huachuca as a tactical automated data processing and analysis system. Using Hawkeye, intelligence personnel could provide decision makers in Desert Storm with more accurate targeting information and all source intelligence.
I ultimately ended up with the 3rd Armored Division headquarters as their AI module testbed Hawkeye support person, you know, pulling in data, modding the system as required, making sure that it stayed up and supporting their combat and intelligence operations, and you know, helping them do the things that made the sweep work. You know, certainly an analysis of what Hawkeye did in theater was a part of that. The end result of that analysis, and there was a lot that went into it, was that for supporting the commanders and staffs, for ease of use, for the kinds of things that our users, you know, were interested in, that this upstart system called Hawkeye did a better job than the primary system that was being developed by the Army at the time called ASAS.
Ultimately, the refined Hawkeye software technology was integrated into the ASAS program. On September 11th, 2001, Fort Huachuca, like the rest of the nation, was on the brink of change. That morning, soldiers formed up on historic Brown Parade Field to acknowledge the changing of command of the U.S. Army Intelligence Center.
An emotional memory of my time there was being in the lead of 1,200 soldiers marching to the parade field for our commanding general's change of command on 9/11. And I remember the feeling I had at that point that my life had just changed, my soldiers' lives had just changed. And what I didn't appreciate at that moment was that America was going to have to change as well. Nobody was going to foresee that we would be at war for a very long time after that.
Within months after I assumed command, we began to alter the curriculum for the training of all Army intelligence specialists. We needed to meet the new realities of combat and the application of intelligence skills as our involvement in combat operations in Afghanistan increased and our insights evolved.
As American forces deployed to Afghanistan for Operation Enduring Freedom, the Intelligence Center began rapidly adapting its training to ensure soldiers could fulfill the combat commander's intelligence needs in a highly complex and constantly evolving operational environment. The Intelligence Center quickly transitioned so that its training environment mirrored the operational environment, and the center provided relevant and immediate support to deployed units. Military intelligence professionals needed to arrive at their units fully trained in the most current tactics, techniques, and procedures being developed in the field, and then transitioned back to the school. With similar terrain and altitude as that in Afghanistan, Fort Huachuca allowed for more realistic training than any other location in the United States. By 2006, the Intelligence Center offered more than 120 programs of instruction to a training population of more than 12,000 students per year at Huachuca, Goodfellow Air Force Base, and Pensacola Naval Air Station. The annual student population increased to nearly 18,000 by 2010. Another 93,000 soldiers worldwide were reached by mobile training teams from Fort Huachuca for specialized training in cultural awareness, human intelligence collection, tactical and interrogation training, and strategic debriefing. The fight in Afghanistan expanded into a culture war, necessitating the creation of new training curriculum and organizations at the Intelligence Center. In addition to the technical and tactical military intelligence training conducted by the 111th MI Brigade and NCO Academy, the Human Intelligence Training Joint Center of Excellence, or HTJCO, trained professional human warfighters to meet current and emerging requirements. A Department of Defense organization, HTJCO officially activated in 2006 to provide standardized human training to personnel from all military services and other national intelligence organizations. Also in 2006, the TRADOC Cultural Center opened to provide mission-focused culture education and training for the Army, sister military services, and other government organizations. Today, the Army Intelligence Center of Excellence, or USACO, at Fort Huachuca works extensively with many partners on post. One of these partners is the Army Network Enterprise Technology Command, or NETCOM, which draws its lineage from STRATCOM of the 1960s. NETCOM remains the Army's single information technology service provider for all network communications, maintaining critical networks in support of national strategy and intelligence infrastructure. JITC, or Joint Interoperability Test Command, first established on post in 1989, continues its mission to test and certify that information and communication systems work together correctly and reliably at the speed of need before they are introduced to the battlefield. The Electronic Proving Ground, or EPG, tests, measures, and proves all developmental types of electronic and communication systems and networks, including intelligence and electronic warfare systems for the military intelligence community. The same unique, interference-free electromagnetic environment that brought EPG to Fort Huachuca in 1954 continues to make the area the prime location for its electronic testing. The nationally protected Buffalo Soldier Electronic Test Range, dedicated in 2010, encompasses a 2,500 square mile area of public and private land surrounding Fort Huachuca for use in unique electromagnetic testing. The range supports almost every major tenant organization on the post. While EPG conducts developmental testing, the Intelligence and Electronic Warfare Test Directorate, IEWTD, is responsible for operational testing of intelligence and electronic warfare, counter-improvised explosive devices, and biometric equipment and systems. Again, the local pristine electromagnetic environment with federally mandated restrictions on the area frequency spectrum supports this testing. In September 2011, IEWTD began its merger with EPG. Responsibility for the Army's UAV programs, now known as Unmanned Aircraft Systems, transitioned from the U.S. Army Intelligence Center to the U.S. Army Aviation Warfighting Center in 2006. Today, the 2nd Battalion, 13th Aviation Regiment, manages the Unmanned Aircraft System Training Center, or UASTC, at Fort Huachuca's Black Tower Complex. The 213th trains U.S. Army and Marine personnel, as well as foreign military students, to be operators, repairers, and technicians for the Shadow, Hunter, Warrior Alpha, and Gray Eagle unmanned systems, sustaining a legacy that began at Fort Huachuca in 1955. The 964 square mile military restricted airspace at Fort Huachuca is the only airspace in the continental United States at which unmanned systems enjoy priority over manned aircraft. With 320 flying days per year, the UASTC conducts training on a near daily basis. Partnering with USACO, these organizations are vital to the intelligence community in accomplishing current and future mission requirements in support of national interests. For more than four decades, the U.S. Army Intelligence Center at Fort Huachuca has provided quality training, combat developments, doctrine, and force structure for intelligence professionals. It has ensured that the thousands of soldiers who have passed through its gates have been thoroughly trained to provide both tactical and strategic commanders with the intelligence needed to protect the nation's security and interests.
Fort Huachuca has been instrumental in my training as a military intelligence professional. From the time that I showed up there and went through my first AIT as 96 Hotel, then I went back, I went to school for what was BNOC then and ANOC, the NCO Academy. All those things, Fort Huachuca, by being the home of intelligence, combines all of the expertise together in one place. It was always a little bit of a homecoming to go back to Fort Huachuca because you saw people that you hadn't seen in several years, and you could hear how someone did it at an armored division as opposed to an infantry division compared to a corps. And you can learn from others in all those different environments.
Your young lieutenants now are coming out with a different view of the world when it comes to what their future is in our Army. And that really is a pretty quick deployment in most cases, whether it was Iraq most recently or Afghanistan or any number of other hotspots around the globe right now. You know, young lieutenant could see them actually exercising decisions that is beyond the training environment and really life or death in some cases decisions, or advising commanders to make those kinds of decisions that lead to life or death. So I think the pressure's more on them than what it ever was with us. And I think that they're coming out with a skill set that's above what I came out with 25 years ago.
Today, as in the past, Fort Huachuca continues to be a significant military installation, not only for Arizona, but for the nation. Captain Samuel Whitside recognized the location's unique characteristics in 1877, and the Army continues to capitalize on many of those capabilities to keep Fort Huachuca relevant and prominent within the Department of Defense. With its electronic testing and training range, military restricted airspace, various airfields and airstrips, as well as its unique topography and fair climate, Fort Huachuca will continue to be an irreplaceable national treasure for years to come. The U.S. Army Intelligence Center of Excellence is proud to call Fort Huachuca the home of military intelligence.
Let's go.